Thank you all for joining us this morning. For those of you who I have not had the pleasure of meeting, I'm Andrea Hadfield, and I work in the Division of Philanthropy at Dana-Farber Cancer Institute. Before we begin our program, I'd like to share some brief housekeeping notes. Please note that everyone's camera and microphone are automatically turned off to ensure that everyone can adequately hear the program. Should you have questions throughout today's program, we encourage you to use the Q&A icon on your screen. We'll have time to address as many of these questions as possible after we hear from our speakers. Lastly, please note that this session is being recorded and the recording will be shared after the program. I'm excited to introduce the doctors who have made some of the most groundbreaking cancer discoveries in recent history. This focus of immunotherapy is a key priority in the recently announced Dana-Farber campaign. More information, including the campaign website, will be shared after the event. Dr. Patrick Ott and Dr. Catherine Wu are pioneers in cancer vaccines. Their radical work has changed the landscape of customized cancer treatment and generated substantial recognition, not only in local publications such as Boston Magazine and the Harvard Crimson, but also most recently in Nature, a highly esteemed journal. They advise the FDA and have shared with the academic community broadly. Today, you will hear what it takes to get this revolutionary point in cancer treatment and what it will take to get this work to the next level and grant access to the countless number of patients expressing their desire every day for these therapies. Finally, to begin our program, I'd like to introduce our speakers for the morning. I've had the great pleasure of working with Dr. Ott and Wu for the last 8 years, and in that time, I've witnessed their extraordinary work move from concept to actual clinical care. And I truly believe we've only seen the beginning of how these two leaders will shape the future of cancer therapies. Dr. Patrick Ott is the clinical director in the Melanoma Disease Center. He's the director of clinical sciences in the Center for Immuno-Oncology and an associate professor of medicine at Harvard Medical School. Dr. Kathy Wu is chief of the Division of Stem Cell Transplantation and Cellular Therapies, the Levine Family Chair for Preventative Cancer Therapies, and a professor of medicine at Harvard Medical School. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Kathy Wu as she begins today's presentation.
Thank you so much, Andrea, for that very warm introduction. And I'm really delighted to be here. This is a picture that we took only 2 years ago, and it really seems like a world away where we were all able to gather together at the Brandegee Estate. And this is really a group of us. We call ourselves the Neovax team. We are clinicians, scientists, biostatisticians, computational folks, immunologists, material scientists, all coming together to kind of bring this sort of vision together. And that vision, next slide, please, is really something that has captured the imaginations of many, including us, which is how do we really harness the power and the specificity of the human immune response in the service of eradicating cancer? And so these are just some images. If you can imagine T cells coming upon a cancer, and recognizing a cancer cell on the basis of what we call antigens. So these are peptides that are on the surface of the cancer. And if the T cell were able to distinguish that cancer as being different from the normal cells of the body, the T cells actually do have this search and destroy function. This is what keeps us healthy and safe from the environment, the pathogens. So why couldn't we use the immune response to actually eliminate cancer cells as well? And so what's shown in the image is kind of contact, engagement, and then destroying the cancer cell. So next slide. So I think that, you know, this kind of concept of tumor immunology and harnessing the human immune response has been around for a long time. But even as we get better and better at the therapies that we're generating, we have a critical challenge in front of us, which is that how can we do better? We have new tools in our toolkit all the time, but only some patients respond. Only some patients respond for a durable moment. So it's been estimated that for some of these new agents that we're hitting about 30% of patients, can we do better than that? And I think one way that as a group we've rephrased the question is, how can we more effectively drive T cells, the soldiers of the immune system, into the tumor, so into the battle site, so that we can more effectively eradicate cancer. So next slide. I think for those of us who have been part of the Neovax group, many of us have been interested in tumor immunology for a long time. But for others, there was really a wake-up call, what I call the Obi-Wan Kenobi moment, only less than a decade ago, which is when some of these new immuno-oncology agents came around. And many of you will, I'm alluding to a Star Wars frame of reference, and some of you will remember that moment when Obi-Wan Kenobi goes into the Death Star and goes, and the radar turns off, and suddenly the Death Shield goes, and suddenly it becomes possible to imagine eliminating the Death Star. And I think really many of us in immuno-oncology always knew that this idea of harnessing tumor immunity would be possible, but it was really the work of these two gentlemen shown here who were the 2018 Nobel laureates and really figured out the basic science behind immune checkpoint therapy that has created the Keytrudas and the different sort of new antibodies that are keeping our cancer patients alive right now. I think that was a moment, you know, and what these immune checkpoint therapies do at some level is kind of disarm this kind of radar shield that the tumor has enveloped itself around. And so that is why I call it the Obi-Wan Kenobi moment. Next slide. And so now you begin to think, well, okay, if we have these great agents that are available, maybe the step two that kind of deals with this immunosuppressive shield, let's say we got that covered, then maybe we need to figure out step one. Step one is how do we get our soldiers into the tumor so that they can do their work and kind of coordinate together with the new agents. And that's where vaccines come in. Next slide. Now, it seems like not a day goes by that I don't see vaccines on the headlines of newspapers. We're talking about it every day, all the time, in relationship to the SARS-CoV-2 pandemic. And certainly in our household, we talk about it all the time. I think that this pandemic has changed the world in terms of how we think about vaccines. I do emphasize that what we're trying to do with those COVID vaccines, like any sort of vaccine, whether it's the flu vaccine or the smallpox vaccine, these are preventative vaccines. We get vaccines to prevent ourselves from getting an infection. For cancer, we hope that we can get there in the future. How wonderful would it be if we could prevent cancer? And there are some ideas in that direction, but for the most part, our patients already have cancer. And so what we're trying to do is what we call therapeutic vaccines, namely to mount immune response against those antigens that are on the surface of the cancer cell and mount that, grow that army of T cells so that they can effectively eradicate the cancer. Next slide. And so if you want to mount a good vaccine, then, you know, how are we going to hit target? What are we going to go after? How can we kind of come together and think about what are those antigens that we should go after? Next slide. And this is where Patrick Ott and I started to work together, because it's been long recognized that tumor mutations, cancers are kind of born and propagated because of tumor mutations. Now, those mutations, at least some of them, will generate peptides that are unique to the cancer, that are not part of the patient's own cells, and maybe we could go after those. And so if you look at this kind of graph, what's unique and really interesting about these tumor mutations is that at least some of them will generate altered peptides that potentially could be recognized by the immune response. So we call these tumor neoantigens, neo-new antigens. So they're not part of the normal complement of antigens that we have in our normal tissue. But what's special about tumor neoantigens is that they're really exquisitely specific to the tumor, not to normal cells, and like pathogens. So like those infectious organisms, they weren't there in our body from the very beginning. And so our normal process for shutting down unwanted reactions to self, immune responses are not there. So what this means is that this class of antigen is tumor specific, and it's really immunogenic. And that is good news for generating vaccines. This is really different than where we have been over the past decades in terms of thinking about cancer vaccines, where we have the type of antigens we've been going after are tumor enriched, but not necessarily specific. And they're variable in terms of how immunogenic they are. So this is super exciting. Now with next generation sequencing, we can suddenly identify these, we can identify the mutations. We can use our kind of computer tools to figure out what are those neoantigens that are specific to that individual patient, and really using our modern technologies to help us get there. Next slide, please. And so now suddenly we're in a moment of a true paradigm shift where we could envision on a patient-by-patient basis, characterizing that tumor through sequencing, finding those mutations, identifying which of those mutations will generate those tags, those antigens on the tumor cell that the immune system can go after. So a really specific multi-pronged attack against the tumor. Next slide. And also really personal. So we know by now, again, through sequencing, that each tumor is a little bit different than the other. So this is a way that we can really customize our immune therapy based on the genetics of that patient's own tumor. Next slide. And so this whole concept is what launched our program called NeoVax. And it was this idea that if we have those Obi-Wan Kenobi reagents, those reagents that will shut down the tumor invisibility cloak, and that's what I'm shown here by the breaks. So what we're basically releasing the breaks from the immune response, we're hitting with the cancer vaccine to help steer the immune response. Maybe in that way, we can expand our army of T cell soldiers so that they're truly tumor specific and that we can get to more efficacious responses with fewer side effects. So that's been our vision. Next slide. Already some time ago, we kind of put these ideas down on paper, and really the concept that we had at the outset, and we really did start this program, it's getting upon almost 10 years ago, we had this idea that we would start with the patient's tumor, we would also sequence the patient's normal cells. Now you have DNA sequencing, you can compare normal tissue tumor, you can identify those mutations. We also know what their HLA typing is. This is kind of the matching that we do, for example, when patients go for bone marrow transplant. We need to know in an immunologic context how those mutations are going to be seen by the immune response. And then we can predict what those peptides are. We came up with a manufacturing strategy. So there's a long track record of using peptides for therapies. So we came up with a way to kind of encode those mutations. And then the idea was to bring it into a syringe to give as a vaccine together with the checkpoint blockade inhibitors. Next slide. And already, as you'll hear shortly from Dr. Ott, from Patrick, we've successfully completed two high priority, highly visible clinical trials, one in high risk melanoma, the other in newly diagnosed glioblastoma. Next slide. And really, if we could just go through this, we've shown that it's safe, feasible, highly immunogenic, and really does combine very well with those checkpoint blockade inhibitors. Next slide. And so now I'm going to pass it over to Dr. Ott, because we've been delighted to work on this project so closely together.
Thanks, Kathy. I'm delighted to be here today and give you a little bit more of a sort of deep down perspective of what all the complex issues that we have to overcome to do this personalized vaccine, what this actually looks like at Dana-Farber. And before I do that, just wanted to actually show you the two articles where we were really delighted to see that our work was very formally by the scientific community honored. Number one in the journal Cell, which is really one of the fundamental biology journals, as really one of the pioneering moments in genomic medicine. And then on the next slide, last year, if you go to the next slide, in Nature, we were listed with those first two trials that Kathy just mentioned as one of the milestones in the 100-year-long vaccine effort. So that was very rewarding. And I just wanted to, on the next slide, tell you really, as I said, kind of how this looks at Dana-Farber and what does it take really to bring all these things together. It's certainly, Andrea already mentioned and Kathy mentioned that it's a very multidisciplinary approach, right? So it really takes clinical people, it takes pathologists, it takes biologists, immunologists, computational biologists, pharmacologists. It's really sort of almost the entire field of medicine is at some point involved in our effort to make these vaccines. And some of the players are shown on the slide here. Really, this program is anchored at Dana-Farber, but we also, within Boston, actually, you know, have reached out to other institutions and the Broad Institute and the MIT is really the two institutions that we collaborate with mainly. But the entire pipeline is really a Dana-Farber effort. Next slide. And so I wanted to give you an example here, what a trial can look like that a cancer patient goes on. This is an example of our melanoma trial that we have designed and that we will start in the near future, where I just wanted to sort of, when you look at the upper portion of the slide here, this is the timeline that a patient gets treated. And so this is already essentially after we have done all our work, which I'll tell you like in the next couple of slides, to make the vaccines, then actually the vaccination starts, which you can see with these red arrows here, right? So we do what's called a prime boost approach, where like every red arrow is one injection of the patient. We give combination therapy, which you can see with these blue squares, and we give like PD-1 inhibition. But then, so that's the treatment part, but there's also the, what we call the correlative analysis part, the part where we really want to learn what those vaccines do to our patients immunologically, meaning like how does the immune response react to this? Is it effective? Does it get activated in an appropriate way? Do we really push the right cells? Do they stay in the blood and in the tumor of the patient for a long time? In order to make sure that we learn as much as we can, we create this pretty challenging program where the patients have these procedures that are called leukapheresis, where they go through something that's almost like a hemodialysis session, where they're getting their white blood cells taken out over a couple of hours. And we do that like before the treatment, after the treatment. And so it's, you know, it takes some, definitely some motivation for our patient. We do serial tumor biopsies. We also get biopsies of the sites where we inject the vaccines. So really in order to learn as much as we can. Next slide. And so I thought it would be useful for this audience to learn about one of our first patients that was actually enrolled in one of those pioneering studies, the melanoma study. His name is Mark Lashray. If we go to the next slide. So his melanoma history started in 2011 when he developed what we call a primary melanoma, meaning like a dark spot that gets diagnosed as a melanoma on his chest. And it turned out that it was what we would call sort of an intermediate risk melanoma. So he received surgery, but then also needed to be treated with a drug called interferon alpha, which we had been using in the past to hopefully lower the patient's chance for recurrence. But it was a pretty difficult drug to take, lots of side effects. He soldiered through that for a year in 2011, and then was followed for the next 3 years until one of the surveillance scans that he received periodically showed a metastasis to the lung. And so that was bad news, but luckily actually at that time, that melanoma was still surgically resectable, meaning it was the only part, it was only one lesion and that was amenable to the surgeon taking that lesion out. And so that was the time when he then came to Dana-Farber and we discussed potential enrollment on this on our Neovax trial. We go to the next slide. And so this is what Mark received. And this is essentially what we already showed you, where the patients get this, when you see on the lower part of the slide, they get these like priming and boosting, but the vaccine itself is actually kind of complicated because you have like multiple peptides where which reflect these neoantigens that Kathy was talking about. So they get typically 20 peptides and they're formulated in different vials, and then they're mixed with a drug that is really meant to induce the immune response or stimulate the immune response in a general sense. And then they actually get, Mark got 4 injections each time. So it is kind of, definitely something to go through for somebody who has to be motivated. I also wanted to point out on the slide is like, if you ask like, well, all this personalized approach and all these efforts, bringing all these people together, the material, just the processes, how much does that cost? It actually costs like more than $100,000 per patient. And so if you go to the next slide, so Mark was vaccinated, went through the whole vaccine regimen, which lasted about 4 months. And then unfortunately, after he was done with that, we found on a follow-up scan, what he showed here on the lower bottom on the left, this left red circle there. There was actually a recurrence, meaning there was actually more melanoma after the vaccination. I will say that this happened fairly quickly after the vaccination. And so we figured, all right, so now this can unfortunately no longer be removed. He needs systemic therapy. So he received a PD-1 inhibitor, which had just become available at the time. And lo and behold, after 4 of these, 4 treatment with this drug pembrolizumab, he actually had a complete response. So all the melanoma disappeared entirely, which is something that we would not necessarily expect with just this drug alone. And this was 6 years ago and he's still fine. So that's why he's like very motivated. He's super happy, obviously. And he's very motivated to like, you know, get photographed with me. And so that's why I'm showing him here today. So if you go to the next slide. So in some sense, if you ask like what, we have these two studies that we already were, you know, recognized for, what else is going on now, right? And that can tell us that we can separate that in sort of 2 categories. One is like, we have an entire portfolio of trials where we test neovax in multiple tumor types, asking several different questions. So we can combine the vaccine with different drugs. We can, what we say, formulate, meaning we can like use different ways to mix the drug to include immunostimulating agents. We can actually think about like, how do we give the vaccine in relation to the combination therapy? We can like vaccinate first and then give like the other drug versus the other way. So there's lots of questions that we can ask in these trials. If you go to the next slides. And then obviously so far we have only done melanoma and glioblastoma. We're now expanding into additional tumor types as you can see listed here, including ovarian cancer, but also actually venturing out into hematologic malignancies, leukemia and lymphoma. And as you can see on the right side, we give neovax in combination with different drugs. And so this is like a very actively ongoing program where we have trials that we accrue patients we expect to get more exciting results from these studies, both on the clinical side, but also obviously by doing all the correlative analysis that I was talking about and looking at the results and hopefully reporting more high level publication and really learning from this and make things better. But there's also a whole other new part of the program, which we call NextVax. If you go to the next slide, and Kathy will tell you about that in the.
Yeah, I mean, I think what you've heard from Patrick is that we have a very, very rich portfolio of clinical trials that we're involved in. And I think what you've appreciated is that the vaccines can really work at all different phases. They can come in early, they can come in late in disease, they can be combined together very well with other therapies. And really, part of our vision is how do you really make this beneficial therapy available rapidly and quickly for all patients and to be used in all sorts of different combinations. So I kind of call it like, can we dial up my vaccine? So if a patient comes into clinic, could we actually get to a point where we are doing clinical sequencing. We know about mutations, and we could in real time generate a vaccine that would be personal for that individual. Now, to be able to get from where we are right now to that vision where within a month, a personal vaccine for a patient could be constructed, we've really envisioned generating what we call a NextVax program. So really focused on how can we get there faster, cheaper, better peptides? Can we think about nucleic acid synthesis and design? I mean, many of us, for example, got mRNA vaccines. That has changed the world in terms of how we think about how vaccines are generated. Is that something that we can make use of? And as we kind of think about our mission against cancer, should we be delivering it using different types of cells to help get us our therapy in the right place? Or should we just be doing this through injections? Next slide, please. And so the very quick answer for how we get there is we do need hand in hand these four different components. So on one hand, we need the engine of basic science, discovery and invention to happen. On the other hand, we need to have really good approaches to manufacturing. So if we have a great idea, how do we actually get that thing in hand so we can give it? The third thing is that with all the new technologies that we have, how do we build our infrastructure for analysis? How do we build our computation, our pipelines? But then number four, we just heard from Dr. Ott all these different trials. So how do we have the right clinical trials infrastructure so that patients can be efficaciously kind of evaluated and seen and treated? So next slide. So this is actually just gives you a little bit of kind of a projected timeline. All the stuff that I talked about has been in the preceding decade. And so I think what I discussed was kind of the originating concept. I didn't go into the nitty gritty of all the stuff that we went through between building pipelines and analysis and all the laboratory testing, but let's just say that all of that work helped us to drive the first two trials that Patrick was intimately involved in. And this has now provided the foundation for us to fan out into all of these different disease areas. And all of these trials in the purple are active, open, accruing. So that's renal cell carcinoma, glioblastoma, melanoma, advanced melanoma, and ovarian cancer. In the green, we have two trials in the blood malignancies that are on the verge of opening in the middle of August. And so we really look forward to taking care of these patients and then also at the same time learning from the patients and propelling us to the next level. But then we both have also talked not only of Neovax, but NextVax. So how do we get to the next level where we can really provide the vaccine for any patient conceptually? And that is something where I just want to emphasize that we could not have gotten there without the help of philanthropy, in the sense that our first chapter, through support of philanthropy with $5 million, really gave us the freedom and the audacity to try new things and to try out these new technologies that were really only being developed and really trying to apply it to our patients. So I would say that those funds helped us do our audacious science and then provided us with funds to actually go on to do the first proof of concept studies. Where we are right now is that philanthropy support would be tremendous for helping on the top half of this graph, which is it takes a lot on an academic center to run these different complex trials across the different centers, again, ranging from the scientific aspects and the clinical aspects and the coordination. And I think the other aspect is the NextVax, which is thinking about the same paradigm where there is effort needed to develop the science, but then also to get us to the first generation proof of concept trials. And so that's kind of our behind the scenes description of our program. So thank you for your attention. So Andrea, back to you.
Great, thank you both. You know, as I was listening to your presentation, we talk about bench to bedside research all the time at Dana-Farber, and it struck me how this example of personalized vaccines at Dana-Farber is the perfect example of a team embodying this approach, and the incredible impact that that's had on patients. So thank you for everything that you've done to create this this program. We received a few questions about specific cancer types and whether or not specific patients would be eligible for cancer vaccines. So can you talk a little bit about, are cancer vaccines for everyone?
So I can, so the short answer is yes, right? So, and I really wanted to, when we talk about personalized vaccine, what we really take pride in is like, this is actually personal. There's a lot of personalized medicine. So that word gets thrown around in oncology a lot. I'm sure a lot of the listeners today have heard about, oh, personalized medicine, right? Oftentimes it actually means selecting a patient based on a mutation that their tumor happens to have. And they're like, you know, basically lucky that they are part of the 5% of have this like ALK mutation or lung cancer. Our program is very different, right? So with this personalized vaccine, we basically look kind of what do we have, right? So because it's so customized, it's not like, oh, does it have, has this patient a BRAF mutation or an ALK mutation? It's like, well, what mutations does the patient have? Let's target those. Now there are definitely, you know, there's variability in terms of how many mutations a tumor has. Actually, one of the main reasons why we started melanoma is because melanoma happens to be highly mutated. And so there was sort of a low-hanging fruit for us. They're like, well, we're not gonna have the problem not finding enough mutations in melanoma. We actually then, like just a year later, ventured into a glioblastoma, which is almost on the opposite side of the spectrum, where that fruit is actually much higher hanging because you actually, our target as we pointed out was like, you try to like get at 20 mutations, and in glioblastoma, you don't always actually get even to 20. In melanoma, sometimes you have thousands. And so I think what we have shown that we can actually create vaccines for most glioblastoma patients too. So in terms of a feasibility perspective, this approach should work for any cancer. In terms of what patient fits, the short answer is also, well, it depends on like what question you ask. There's certainly, we are asking, so we have, the first study was in a sort of preventative setting, as I told you, right? So Mark had no melanoma at the time he actually was vaccinated, right? So he had a surgery and everything, all the melanoma was removed. The main goal was to hopefully to lower his chance for the melanoma to come back. Now that didn't really work, but then actually sort of that, at least that's what we think, because we actually had another patient where we saw the same phenomenon, that vaccine actually reset his immune system so that it actually had these T cells that Kathy was talking about that are really, that we want to drive into the tumor, and they were sort of primed and ready, sort of as similar as sort of like your COVID vaccine T cells, right? Or antibodies that we do with a COVID vaccine, right? So basically, you set the immune system up, and then actually the treatment itself is the PD-1 inhibitor. They're very much reliant on these primed T cells actually being already in the body. And so Mark was really lucky that we were able to induce this response. It's just like an example that illustrates, like, now we are wondering, well, would it be better to go into a preventative setting? Should we give the vaccine before we give the PD-1 inhibitors? In theory, like, you can go into any cancer. There isn't really like an a priori, like, oh no, this doesn't work in like lymphoma or so, right? So we haven't proven it, but we are pretty confident that's the case.
Yeah, I think I would agree exactly with Patrick. I mean, the approach that we describe is a cross-cutting approach. So it's not specific to any particular cancer. It is true that we have, we're trying to set, what Patrick is describing is that the vaccines are setting up the system up for success. So the vaccine is helping the anti-PD-1 antibody work better. In terms of the clinical settings that we've gone in through so far, these are at some level the maybe more straightforward settings that we've been able to confront so far, but there's no reason why we can't go into others. That being said, there are some challenges. So for example, our approach is currently very dependent on identification of mutations for the generation of the vaccine. And it's true in the pediatric setting that in general, those numbers are less. But I think it's still an open question, a question that we and others are looking at, which is how many good responses do you need? So how many mutations do you need to go after? No one knows, more than one, I would say. So I think multi-pronged attack is the way that we want to go. I would say the other thing is that we're getting better and better at how we detect mutations. So there are many different flavors of mutations. And just because we started out our program looking at one type of mutation doesn't mean that there aren't other mutations, other styles of mutations that can also generate these neoantigens. And I would say that in the pediatric setting, there may be a really different type of mutation profile than what we would find in an adult melanoma.
Thank you. And so what do you see as some of the barriers to bringing vaccine to standard therapy across the world?
Well, I mean, and an obvious barrier is cost, right? Another one is certainly the amount of time it takes to make the vaccine. So sometimes that's actually very sort of concrete problem. If say there's a cancer patient that has metastatic disease, right? So you can't really say like, well, you have metastatic disease. Can you like wait 3 months for us to like customize your vaccine for you? So ideally, that time would be much shorter, right? So that's something that we are trying to tackle with this NextVax program that Kathy was also, alluding to. It's certainly, we wanna be encompassing as many mutations as we can, but we also wanna long-term, hopefully simplifying things a little bit, right? But it's a, sort of the key challenge is what we usually say, it's like time and cost, right? That being said, what I also like to point out is like, it's actually the vaccine itself. So there is not really a naturally built in like time that that it will always take no matter what you do technologically, right? So in theory, you could actually make this vaccine in like 3 weeks or in 2 weeks or so, right? Because it's like all the processes that we do, they take a long time because it's very, it's an academic operation. There's lots of like people involved, but workflows can be optimized, right? And so it's certainly if you just have to prove that it works and then you can work on that, or like do it obviously in parallel.
And these are exactly the things that we're thinking about. So how do we address time and cost? There's another aspect, which I think some of the questions that are in the chat, I think Richard Anders has asked a few questions that is really central to kind of our program, which is also trying to get to fundamental biology and understanding the barriers that the cancer is lobbing at us. So if we can understand that kind of, whether you call it an invisibility cloak or the radar shield, whatever how do we kind of penetrate that immunosuppressive environment? And the most obvious example is checkpoint blockade as a modality, but certainly there are others. Patrick, maybe you can talk a little bit about the trial that is already designed in metastatic melanoma with the CD40. So there's definitely other agents depending on the biology of that tumor.
So there's, and I think so also to this question, right? So there's, so what's extremely innovative, what we're doing is like the target as Kathy explained, but actually the, when we say like the formulation or what's the right combination and what's the right like immune stimulant, those questions are all still actually unanswered. One of the studies that Kathy just mentioned is actually getting at that that question, right? Where we're basically using a sort of more innovative, I would say, right? So what we used in our first study was like what we thought at the time was the best immune stimulant, but they're actually better that are around now that we can use and we can translate into the clinic. So it's really, to this question, like why doesn't the tumor prime itself? Like it oftentimes does, right? But it's really about tailoring the response and kicking the immune cells butt like in the best way, right?
Yeah, I think cancer is just remarkable in terms of how it can just shut things down. So I think that it behooves us to understand all of those different exit strategies that the cancer figures out. And then, so I think on one hand, we are really dealing with ultimate personalization. So personalization in terms of the vaccine, but personalization also in terms of thinking from cancer to cancer, what are the preferred modes of evasion? And can we combine the vaccine together in a smart fashion to address that sort of challenge? And I think I showed you in the very first slide, our retreat at the Brandegee Estate. And one of the things that we actually, that was a retreat, but actually we come together every single week on Friday and we chat about these things. And we kind of think about in a multidisciplinary fashion, how should we design our trials? What is the new information that we're getting? What is the new data that we're generating? What are we learning about the tumor? How can we implement that into clinical trials? And that's actually been probably really one of the best and fun things about being here.
That's great. And Patrick, in the presentation, you mentioned that the per patient cost is $100,000. Does insurance cover any of those costs? And if not, how are those costs covered?
So yeah, insurance doesn't cover any of the vaccine costs, right? So when we do a trial, insurance covers some of the standard things that we do, like a patient coming in, being seen in the office, or an infusion nurse doing like the standard of care treatment. But making the vaccine, including this complex process that we talked about, that's all basically funded from the sources that we mentioned, right? So we have, cobbled together grant money, and we have been really, as Kathy pointed out, right, the whole thing got started with philanthropy. It wouldn't have been possible without philanthropy. And so we are, tapping different resources, but the short answer, it is time and cost, right? And cost is really most prohibitive for us. And it also has, in some sense prevented us from, if folks are wondering like why are you not already like doing larger trials, or why you're only now starting going into other tumor types when we have been in this field for like 8 years, as we mentioned. Well, part of it is definitely like it can only, we have to cobble everything together. It's very much an academic effort, and I think it's helpful, I feel, to point out that that's very different from like an industry effort, right? So there's a lot of like industry things that are going on. And somebody may wonder, well, why don't you have like BioNTech doing the work, or Genentech doing the work? Well, what we can do differently is really this academic. So I think we give it really our own love. We have like, we're really dedicated. And I can tell you, I've like really lived and I've told that some of the donors that I've worked with, right? So it is, that's been the fun of it too, right? So we can actually mold our own, we can ask our own questions. We are certainly more, in some sense, limited because we don't have like the big, pockets that a company may have. But we can actually, we have the patience, we have the know-how, we have the smart people, right? In the labs, are coming up with new things in the lab that we can really use that new technology to like, and Kathy has been like phenomenal, right? With like the immunogenomics, like analysis that we're literally, when we started the first study, a lot of the technologies that we use now to learn about the immune responses were not even developed yet, right? And so we actually, I think the first study was also an amazing sort of example of that, where we had this Nature paper in 2017. And then since 2017, like Kathy developed this laboratory where we can like now on a single cell level in a much more sophisticated way, learn about these immune responses. And then we went back and said, like, well, how about these patients, like, after 5 years, do they actually still have immune responses? And then, well, what about we use like those single cell technologies now? Can we actually find out like what the clonality of these T cells are, what the phenotypes function? And so we basically, you know, I called some of the patients, had we had them come back, we got more blood, and this became like another effort, and we, you know, published that in Nature Medicine like early this year. So that's something that we can do. That's like part of what drives us, I think, also, right? So this, you know, when we said like the recognition that we get, like as an academic, that's kind of what some of the motivation that we have. But of course, like it's always like the most important thing is to like ultimately really make things better for patients, right?
I want to circle back into that kind of idea of the ability of donor funds to have helped start this program. So I think, you know, we started this program at a pretty earlier time in my career. And at some point I was asked to give a talk in Texas to mentor MD PhDs. And they were asking about, you know, how Neovac started. And one young woman raised her hand and she said, how are you able to do such a risky thing? Because it was a risky thing to do all of this as a junior faculty member. You know, I think when we go on the academic track, you know, you have to kind of get through and create your own scientific vision. And there is a tendency to want to be a little bit more risk averse just so that you are on a very tried and true path. And this was really a little bit out there. And at that very moment, I realized it was philanthropy that made it possible, that I had the security of knowing that I could try something that, you know, you couldn't stop thinking about it. At nighttime, you're like, you know, you're sitting there going, we really have to do this. We really have to do this, but no one has ever done sequencing like this before. How's this gonna work? And at that very moment, I realized it was philanthropy. The other kind of conversation that I had, and this was at a conference that Patrick and I were at in Canada, that's when I realized that Patrick is a wicked badass skier. So you don't want to go skiing with Patrick. He just, I told him endlessly that I was in the green to blue zone. And he said, uh-huh. And then we got off anyway, he's a very good skier. But at that conference, it was a conference with a lot of immunoengineers. So engineers who want to figure out how to make things like vaccines better. And one person went up to me and said, you have no idea what Patrick's Nature paper describing that first trial has done to the field. It has inspired and motivated engineers everywhere. They just want to make it better. And I think that's actually, I'm excited for the field. I'm excited for where we're headed. I'm excited that there's so much energy that we've been able to contribute to that energy. But I also think that we have to do better, right? So we have a lot of, this is one final funny anecdote, which is that I have a son, he's 15 now, but when he was 10, he always is able to see the big world. He's a funny kid, but he came up to me one Sunday and said, mom, how many drugs are there that really, really cure cancer? And I was like, and he said, you have a lot of work to do. And then he ran out. So we do have a lot of work to do, but I think that we know where we want to go. And I think we know what we have to do. And we know that it's a balancing act between learning from the clinical trials, harvesting all that we can from the science, putting it all together, and that requires a team. And that's what I hope we've shown you today. I wanted to address some of the specific questions. I think Richard Anders asked about a little bit about the density of neoantigens that have been studied, and this is definitely something that we're interested in. I would say in general, neoantigens tend to be more lowly expressed, and maybe that also contributes to why T cells that are directed to neoantigens are so strong and so sensitive. You know, they have to be able to find those kind of low-level expressing targets. I think another person asked about ovarian cancer vaccines, and this is something, a trial that's just opening now, and we're very excited about it. These are for women who have already received paclitaxel, and it's a schedule not very different from what Patrick showed you, where patients get vaccine, but they also get PD-1 antibody. And we have assembled a whole team and a program to work on that. Andrea, I could keep going, or do you want to keep going down the questions as you like?
Yeah, thank you for answering those specific questions. There was a question about preventative vaccines, and I know that we talked about that a little bit in the beginning, but I think because it is such a hot topic now, can you explain, are there preventative vaccines for cancer?
No, it depends on what you mean by preventative, right? So there's primary and secondary prevention that we like to talk, to divide it up. Certainly the COVID vaccine is a primary prevention, right? So it's like somebody never saw the virus, they should be protected from it. So I'm specifically talking about that, when you talk about the personalized vaccine approach, you kind of need to know what the tumor looks like in order to customize a vaccine for it. So I think a primary prevention vaccine using this approach is, I would say, not fundamentally impossible, but probably with the know-how that we have right now, difficult. That being said, right, I mean, the long-term vision, you can, you know, monitor like very small amounts of tumor cells in the blood. There's certainly like, you know, thoughts in the field already where it can say like, well, you know, does a patient actually have circulating tumor cells and what do they look like? And can be like actually vaccinated against that, right? I mean, it's certain, and that would be actually, that may be the best setting of all. But of course it's like, that is very different from a therapeutic vaccine. It's even very different from this, the secondary preventive vaccine where somebody already had the cancer. We know exactly what the problem is. And in some way it's like, the challenge is like the vaccine itself, but also the numbers, right? So, well, I mean, we're talking about hundreds of millions of patients are being vaccinated for, and not patients, Americans and globally, right? Being vaccinated against, but not everybody has cancer, fortunately, right? So there would be a very different like stake in terms of the numbers. But I would say not fundamentally impossible.
I would add to that, just so one of the attendees asked about liquid biopsy, Mike Genovese, and that is definitely an area of interest. I think there's broad recognition that a liquid biopsy could be a powerful way that's not so invasive to monitor whether a tumor is present. But there's already been publications by our colleagues on how liquid biopsy, and this is at the Broad, can be used to identify neoantigens. We definitely have research efforts underway, even adjacent to our neovax trials, to look at the role of liquid biopsy for detection of disease. So that's ongoing right now in the renal study, in the GBM study, but also in the ovarian group is also interested in using liquid biopsies to learn if we could use that as a modality to identify neoantigens. But I emphasize that these are all, you know, postdoc level research projects that are ongoing, but of a very high interest. My only add to the to Patrick's answer about the preventive vaccines, I think there's two settings that there is a little bit more activity. So I think one is where in the familial predisposition syndromes, such as Lynch syndrome. So these are syndromes where patients are pretty much destined by their adult life to get cancer. And there's already been some nice published work from our Broad colleagues that have identified certain type of mutations and classes of mutations that happen in those patients. So one of the, again, ongoing research projects is to how do we generate a vaccine that could target those specific associated mutations, and could that be a prevention type of trial? There are also some efforts in Lynch syndrome happening at NIH and also in Texas. The other area is that in the blood malignancies, we often talk about predisposition conditions. So for myeloma, for example, there's MGUS, and then for chronic lymphocytic leukemia, there's MBL, and it's an ongoing question about whether or not we could try to characterize these kind of early stage conditions, knowing that there's maybe few mutations in those type of samples. And would that, for example, change the natural history of disease? But I think at some level, we certainly have many different things on our plate. So we gotta figure out how to deal with metastatic cancer. And then on the other end of the spectrum, we have to figure out how to prevent cancer. But these are all theoretically feasible. I think it depends on resources and good ideas to kind of get us to the next step.
That's great. Thank you so much. I want to be mindful of our time. And I just feel so inspired by what has happened so far and where you're headed next. And I just think, as a philanthropy professional myself, I am so inspired by supporting people who are up at night thinking about what's next and what they can bring to patients. So thank you for your tireless efforts. It's really incredible. And just makes me appreciate Dana-Farber even more than I have. And so thank you to our audience as well for your active participation, and for Patrick and Kathy for your presentation. It was really, really excellent. And, you know, we are so grateful to all of our supporters. And as you heard today, it wouldn't be Neovax and NextVax is not possible without philanthropic support. So thank you for considering to support this effort and to support faculty at Dana-Farber. You know, you really are the team that makes it happen. So on the screen, you'll see priorities of our recently announced Dana-Farber campaign. And in the interest of time, I'm not going to go through all of them, but I did want to share this information, and it will be shared in a post-event email that will be sent soon. And I also wanted to mention that if you were inspired by today's talk, there's other ways to be involved. Of course, you can make a philanthropic donation to the Dana-Farber campaign website, to the faculty that's presented today. You could donate blood or platelets at our Kraft Center for our Kraft Family Blood Donation Center. Attend future Behind the Breakthrough events listed on defycancer.org, and spread the word. You know, be our ambassadors. Share our mission and campaign to defy cancer on your social media platforms. Attend Jimmy Fund events, and thank you for all that you do. After the event, you will receive a survey. We'd love to hear from you. This is, I believe, our 26th or 27th program from Behind the Breakthroughs. We really want to hear from you on what you'd like us to cover and topics that matter to you. So thank you again. Enjoy the rest of your day. An email will follow with all this follow-up information. So please feel free to let us know if you have any questions. But in the meantime, thank you again, Kathy and Patrick. It was really excellent.
Thank you for having us.
Thanks for having us.